Steve's Buggy! Welcome back to Suffocating in Suburbia. I'm Stevie GB, your host, your only host. And today, I have a great guest. This is a guy, this is in the series that I've sort of developed about the Record Stop alumni. And I've been working on a book forever called Record Stop Imports and Outcasts. And I think it's a great title because that's really what it was all about. And this guy, I remember from the band that I loved back in the late 70s called Ears. Ears, that's right, Ears. They were crazy, they were wild, they were fun. It's the kind of music you don't hear anymore. We'll talk about that a little bit. This is what bothers me. Nobody's writing music that's fun anymore. There's no sense of humor in modern music. It's all about love and lost love and whatever else. I don't even know what it's about, but it's not fun. I'm going to say that. That's my opening monologue. So this guy went on to great things, as many Record Stop alumni. And he's a video director. I hope I'm saying that title correctly. He'll correct me if I'm wrong. And he's worked with such acts that you may have heard of as, let me see, the Beach Boys, Don McLean, Grand Funk Railroad, Garth Brooks, and many, many others, along with some indie bands. And I watched all his videos. I loved them. I especially liked X-Teens, a lot of 80s stuff, really cool, power pop, really great stuff. And we'll talk about all that. His name is Steve Boyle, and I'm going to bring him on right now. In fact, he's already on. You see him. Ladies and gentlemen, he looks like my brother. We got the same glasses. Steve Boyle. How are you, Steve?
Oh, just happy to be here. Thank you very much for inviting me.
Oh, yeah, yeah. So you've really had quite an illustrious career since last I saw you. You were just a guitar player in that crazy rock and roll band, Ears.
Yeah.
With John Delgazio, who was like stealing the limelight from everybody, whether you liked it or not.
Well, he was writing all the songs too, and he was lead singer, and he was the show. He was great.
He was great.
Well, I say what?
Have you seen him recently?
I'm sorry?
Have you seen him or kept in touch with him at all?
Yeah, I keep up with him. He's on the West Coast these days. So living a quiet life out there.
Good for him.
In fact, for that matter, hey, John and John Gamble and Ed Tracy and Mike Salambini and Jim Sheridan and Mike Newman, who seems to have gone underground. So those are the guys from Ears.
Yeah, they were great guys. It was a great band. I enjoyed listening to you guys. And I think it was Ed's basement. Was it Ed Tracy's basement?
It was probably John's basement.
I think it was John.
We did go to Ed's basement once or twice, but usually it was John's basement. Occasionally it was, for a short time, it was my parents' house because they were in Europe. So I was able to abuse privileges there.
Okay.
To this day, I don't think they know that. When my mother finds out, I'm going to get in trouble.
Hey, maybe she'll forgive you. Thank God your mother's still alive. Mine,
yeah, so far, so good.
I like when parents say, how are your parents? Are they still alive? I said, no, they're still dead. And that always looks like a mixed. I know. It's a little dark. It's a little dark.
That's all right. So, but yeah, Ears was a lot of fun. And it was a great experience. It got me going into what I wound up doing into music videos and all that sort of stuff.
Yeah.
So
I remember I saw you guys at the Sachem High School.
And I have something. I've got something fun to show you.
Oh,
right over here. Can you see it?
Wow.
It's the master tapes.
Look at that.
With my cheesy handwriting. And I just had it. And of all recording studios in Nashville, it's called Welcome to 1979. And they had the gear to transfer this. I just got it yesterday. Just got it digitized yesterday. So
that's amazing.
I ran across a box of all these quarter inch audio reel to reel tapes. And I was thinking, you know, do I go on eBay and pick up a deck for a few hundred bucks? But then again, it's probably, you know, half track and these are probably full track and it won't play. And I was just, forget it, I'll call a studio. I certainly know enough studios in town. Mm-hmm. And had them digitize a couple of tapes. They digitized that. They digitized the Ears demo.
Wow.
With Pass the Vaseline, Brother Mark, Huh What, Steve's Boogie. Oh my goodness. That's a total of like 30 seconds. And
Pass the Vaseline, Brother Mark. I think I remember that one.
And then I found this. We recorded over a radio show called Rock Around the World with Donovan, but it's WBAB. It seems that I was on WBAB.
Wow.
For doing some sort of little promotion.
Wow.
I have no memory of that whatsoever. I kept a diary back in 1977, a little notation thing. Not it wasn't very emotional, like, dear diary, you know what happened to me today. But and it mentions the WBAB stuff, and I was like, really? I don't remember that at all.
Those were the days.
But I've got the audio. I haven't heard it yet.
Oh.
So it'll be interesting. I said, I just got it last night. So, but I'll pull. I've speaking of Sachem, there's a song called Huh What, and I used the audio from the Sachem High School show over our performance at UB's OTJ, and which was my first music video back in 1977.
Skit out for your love.
Listening to this last night, If You Can't Win Fairly Cheat is a possible song for a music video. I may do some music videos out of these. Right. And what else was there? While In Your Waist, Why Don't You? It was pretty good. That may happen.
That was sort of your signature song, I think.
I don't know. They're all a signature song. If I Can't Win Fairly Cheat, yeah, I think out of this batch, those two, and then I've got, we also did some recording at Ultrasonic Recording Studios in Hempstead.
Wow.
They had a special, I think we bought it, I think there was an ad in Good Times Magazine or something, where you can come in the morning, some odd morning, and pay cheap amount of money, and it's really demo time. You come in the morning, you play your song straight up live, you get a recording, you get booted out the door.
Hmm.
So we paid for that. And in fact, we wound up, Billy Joel was recording the Turnstiles album, and he was in that night. And I had to push his piano out of the way to set up my guitar. And the reason why I knew it was his piano was because stenciled on the side of the piano was said Billy Joel in big Prince stencil. So it must have been his practice piano or whatever. And we had his engineer. So the guy that engineered Turnstiles was the guy that recorded us at
that's pretty impressive.
Yeah. And so I may pull one of those songs too. In fact, If You Can't Win Fairly Cheap from that will probably be the one I'll use, and maybe I can't remember, there was something else in Sachem I like, but it's anyway. So what I've been doing during the pandemic are what they call lyric videos for artists. And what it is, it's if you give me an audio track, I just put any old piece of crazy nonsense video on top of it. And so I've been pulling archives. I've been working with stock footage, and I create animations or all these different weird text graphics. And I just build music videos out of that. And they've done well. And so I thought, well, I'm doing that for everybody else. Why don't I do that for myself?
So
I'll do a couple of years videos just for the fun of it. In fact, I was going to work. I'd be working on one today, but I'm here talking to you instead.
Oh. So. Well, I feel honored.
No,
so
you're
let me ask you this. So let me ask you this: when you listen to Ears now, is it cringy, or do you enjoy it? I mean, what's the feeling? Is it nostalgic?
Stuff is great. That's a really good question.
Yeah.
For many years, it was painful. No, it was cringy. Yeah. No, it was how fast can I burn the tapes? It was not something I listened to.
Right.
You grow past these things. But as the years go on, and I listen back to it now, Everybody was considered a punk band, and I never thought of us as a punk band. We called ourselves that because that was the genre and that was the era and that's what was going on at the time. But I didn't think we were punk. I thought we were just a comedy group. We were a cross between Frank Zappa and Blue Oyster Cult, as how I kind of thought of us.
That's a perfect description.
But it actually is a lot of both in there. Being that, especially Blue Oyster Cult, since Buck Dahmer and Sandy Perlman went to Smithtown High School. Hmm. They went to my high school. And Buck's younger brother, John, was my... I went to school with him. He was my... I took a mechanical drawing class, and he was my mechanical drawing buddy.
Oh, funny.
Yeah, almost... There's an escapade that both of us almost got expelled, but thanks to my quick action, we didn't. But that's a whole nother story. But he used to tell me stories about his brother's band. And they had a band house in St. James. It was walking distance from where I lived.
Wow.
But yeah, but that's a Blue Oyster Cult. Anyway, but I listen to the tracks now. And I've done a couple of little edits in there because a lot of these things are live and, you know, we're missing, there's a little mistake here or it's meandered, somebody's missed a cue and it's going on an extra couple of bars. And so I cut the music down to where it should be. And doggone it, it's punk. It's punk with a sense of humor.
A huge sense of humor.
A song called Wallow in Your Waste, Why Don't You? Is not taking life too seriously. Or Someone Dropped a Safe on My Grandma's Head. All these long title songs. Although there was a song called Rover. That's a short
Rover.
Title. Rover. It was a love song to a dog.
To a dog. I remember.
Yeah. Over and over the fields of clover, hand and paw with Rover. I buckle at every wet kiss. This is Delgazo.
Wasn't there one where it was a long joke about clothes, but we have clothes but no cigar? Wasn't that another?
Oh, yes. Clothes but no cigar. Yeah, I forget how that one went. Yeah. There's a bunch.
Flowing hormones through me.
And so I'm going through them now, and they're kind of fun. So I'm picking ones I liked, at least decent performances, and that sound, have some sort of decent sonics to it, and then tightening them up where it was loose, you know, and fixing little things. Two have come out, and I'll probably do at least another one, if not two more, with an option of a third, depending on, you know, if people don't threaten me after the next one.
Now, does Ears have any kind of a fan base? Is this something that people are...
You know, I've got a fan. I occasionally get a little bits of fan mail, but not a big... No, if there's a half a dozen people out there that remember us, that's a big fan base for us. You know, that's a big fan base for us in 1977, if there are half a dozen people that remember us. So, to me, it was the experience.
Yeah.
You know... The Beatles land in New York, and I'm loving this stuff, but I can't get involved in it. I'm a little kid,
right?
You know, when you pick up the magazines, and there's 16 magazine and things like that, and all they care about in there is what's the Beatles' favorite color and what are they like in girls. It's like, really, I'm not interested in this.
Right.
And then hippies show up, and Woodstock happens, and I want to get involved in that. Heck, I wanted to go to Woodstock. My mom wouldn't let me go.
Right.
Because we used to vacation in that area. I knew the area. I could get up there.
How old were you then at 16?
14.
Oh, okay. You're a couple of years older than me. I was born.
So I'm 14, but I'm still a little kid. I'm not allowed to go. Yeah. So I'm trying to get involved in these things. And then the 70s thing happens. And then I'm old enough. By then, my parents can't tell me I can't go. So Ears happened as partly as a joke and partly by accident. I graduated from Smithtown High School. I was doing cultural anthropology courses on the side. And so I was going to be an anthropologist. And first semester, I wanted to go to NYU. But my parents are immigrants. Their attitude was, what, you graduated high school? That's more than we did. Mm-hmm. And so I couldn't afford it, even though I was accepted. So I went to Suffolk Community College and working full time and then going to school full time. So I could work full time to pay for school. And I had a small scholarship, not very much. So after the first semester, I realized I can't continue in anthropology because there was a huge recession on. There's no money. Who's going to keep me going in grants? And so I thought, well, what kept everyone going in the Depression and what made money? And Hollywood did. And I thought, well, I want to go. I always liked music anyway. So I started the radio station at Suffolk Community College called WSCC. And out of that, and it's 74, 75, and 1974, 1975, and it's all, the records that are coming out, I was getting fed up. The record company reps would come in on occasion to check in and bring, hawk whatever the newest album is. Mm-hmm. And I was getting fed up with the meandering bass solos and drum solos and guitar solos. And it's all like, get to the freaking point, And a guy comes in from the record label, goes, hey, you'll like this album here. It's here, play this, anything on any side. So I'm listening to it. I put on this track and it's Beat on the Brat with a baseball bat. I was like, who are these guys? I love them. There's the song is 2 minutes. They're funny. They get to the point. I like them. Who are they? He goes, they're the Ramones. The Ramones? They don't look related. Where are they from? Queens. Queens? Queens is down the road. Are they playing anywhere? Yeah, they're playing in a club in the Bowery. I was like, the Bowery? Who would put a club in the Bowery? That's where you go to get stabbed, And he goes, yeah, it's something with letters, CBGB. I was like, oh, great, I'm going.
CBGB.
Yeah, so I wound up hanging out at CBGB's.
Yeah.
This isn't whatever this is, 75, I guess, early 75.
Yeah.
And I'm discovering the Ramones, all the local, and they're just local bar bands. So the Ramones and Blondie and Talking Heads and the Dictators, who I love.
Right.
The Dictators.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And actually, the Ramones, Dictators, and Patti Smith were the only ones with record labels, deals at the time. Mm-hmm. And Go Girl Crazy from the Dictators had come out. And so I would, would play all that. Yeah. And so that got me going, thinking, I want to be in a band. So the guys in the band come out of the radio station. So Del Gazo was part of the radio station. John Gamble was part of the radio station.
Wow.
Ed Tracy, I think, was part of the radio station as well. We acquired Mike Salambini and drums and Jim Sheridan from the drums was on from the radio station too. So, and then John came up with all these crazy, crazy funny songs. We just talked our way into playing a bunch of clubs all over the place.
Wow.
And the only reason why we were playing CBGB's or Max's Kansas City is because they would let, they were okay. They wanted original music. Mm-hmm. All the other clubs all around wanted copy bands. If you could do the best of Free or Grand Funk Railroad or Mott the Hoople or whoever else was happening at the time, then yeah, you could play. But on Long Island, it was UB's OTJ, and that was about it. And they were the home of the Good Rats and Twisted Sister, although Twisted Sister was a cover band at the time. And that was really it for Long Island. We had a couple of other clubs we played, but they weren't as big. We actually played the Daisy once in Amityville. That was the club that Kiss came out of.
Oh, really?
Yeah. In fact, the owner, who's the manager and bartender, came out of his way to show me a picture of him with Gene Simmons. And Gene Simmons at the time was dressed, they were a drag act originally. So there's Gene in a white sequence gown and a white wig. He's tall enough as it is. He's got the white, he looked like Gene Harlow more than Gene Simmons. And, that's when they first started out. We played there. But there weren't many clubs that would accept original music. And I did not want to be a cover band.
Right, right.
So, and CBGB's was one of them. So that's why we played there.
That's great.
Not so that you had
ears.
Famous.
Ears is great. And then you moved on. You started doing videos of ears. And I read from your North Carolina, which is very interesting, where you just took that knowledge and went to other bands and say, hey, let me do a video of you. And you just.
Right. So, yeah, I was working for Viacom. I was going to college and working for Viacom. And then finally I quit school and then continued to work for Viacom. And so I rented the truck, a remote truck, one day, and which had two cameras, and I got friends in to crew it. And we shot video of the band at UB's OTJ and then made a music video out of that and then didn't know what to do with it because it's 1977 and there's no place to play these things. MTV doesn't even launch until 1981 and they're not national until almost 83. But I got lucky. We were loading into Max's Kansas City. And you have to load in through the front door. And I'm the last one to load in. And I'm trying to haul a Marshall 50-watt head and my Dan Armstrong heavy guitar. And out come, and there are two doors at Max's. There's the one door that's got the, it, you walk upstairs to the club. And the other door is to the restaurant. That's right. And out of the door from the club, and this is late afternoon, is Andy Warhol. And I'm like surprised going, I've never seen him during the daytime. I've only seen him at night. I didn't know Andy Warhol came out during the daytime. And he's looking at me and he's waving at me like he's going to hold the door for me. Yeah. And I'm thinking, it's Andy Warhol. I'm like going, no, it's okay. You can go. He goes, no, I'll wait for you. I'll hold the door. No, you can go. And finally just shrugs and he goes over to the restaurant. So I had my opportunity to talk to Andy Warhol and I didn't do it because I was starstruck.
Oh, that's the worst. The
one and only time in my life. I've hung around with a lot of big deal stars. I've even stayed at some of their houses. I've never been starstruck only once. And that was it. And so I load in at Max's. And as I'm loading in, I see the bartender and he's got a big video deck. He's trying to load it behind the bar. And I drop everything to help him. And because I recognized the gear and I said, what are you doing with this? And he said, we're going to put some TVs over here. We're going to play video. I was like, oh, great. I got a video of my band. Will you play it, please? And he said, yeah, sure. He goes, yes, please. We were dying. I got nothing. Andy Warhol just dropped a clip off. And one of the guys from New York Dolls dropped something off. And that's all I've got. Mm-hmm. So the world premiere of my first music video was behind the bar at Max's Kansas City between clips delivered by Andy Warhol and the New York Dolls. Wow. And so I wound up in North Carolina. I just got tired of starving in New York and wound up getting a job with WRAL TV, which is an ABC at the time was an ABC affiliate in Raleigh, the second largest TV station in the state. And I thought, well, now that I'm here, where's the music scene? Oh, I want to be part of the music scene. And sure enough, there was one there, not realizing that just because you're in a city doesn't mean they have a music scene. Most of them don't. I just got lucky. And what had happened was the scene was later titled Combo Land, which was the precursor to something called Jangle Pop. Had it not been for Combo Land, there would never have been Jangle Pop. And this was really comes out of the two producers of the time, Don Dixon and Mitch Easter, who were producing all these bands. And I knew both of them, Don in particular. Don was in a band called Arrogance, and they were signed to Warner Brothers at the time. And so I take my little Max's Kansas City ears video around all these bands and pull the routine I pulled in New York, which is if you want to get part of the scene and know the clubs, and if you know the clubs, figure out who the manager is, make friends with the manager. If the manager isn't the owner, find the owner too. This way you can get in and out of the club whenever you feel like it, use it for locations. This way you can meet everybody, which I did in Raleigh, and then hawked my way in this video until I got a band that would say yes. And then once I was in, I started directing music videos with them, which was like me going to school. And I got
where
lucky.
Where would these videos play? They would play in the club because there was no MTV then.
Well, there was something called HBO. So HBO had a show called Video Jukebox. And it was the music video show to be on. And my third music video in the Raleigh area was for a group called Glass Moon. and they were on Atlantic Records. They had a remake of the Hollies on a Carousel.
I watched that video. It was cool.
And it was a top 40 hit. Really? I remember Casey Kasem on America's Top 40 talking about it. And it played to death that year on Video Jukebox, and it was played as interstitial programming in between movies on HBO. And so here I was. I know Schooner show up, and I wind up with a national hit. Right. And so I did a bunch of videos for a few years, and it was fun because I documented the scene. Had I stayed, REM was coming in 1983. I was trying to talk my way into an REM video when they had pressed their own single for Radio for Europe.
Wow.
And Don was producing their first EP, but I wound up deciding it was time for me to go. I had gone as far as I could with the market. The bands that I had worked with in the early 80s, by 84, 83, 84, were breaking up. And I thought, well, it's time for me to break up too. And so I wound up moving. I wanted to move to a bigger market and wound up in Nashville because of a TV network called TNN, the Nashville Network.
Huge.
And wound up getting a job there.
Wow.
And then doing the same thing. Same routine, figure out the clubs, figure out the bands, figure out the scene. There was a music scene. It's Nashville. Of course, there's a music scene. But it was a big rock scene, too, and got involved in that. And then wound up doing a video for a guy by the name of Bill Lloyd, who's really known in power pop, but was also had, wound up getting, he was a songwriter and at a music publishing company called MTM. Music publishing, MTM being the initials of Mary Tyler Moore. Mm-hmm. And so she had a music publishing company in Nashville. And Bill was signed to the publishing company to write music for them. And so I would hang out with him, and he introduced me to his pal, his co-writer, Radney Foster. In fact, one of the first times in there to meet Radney, he was going on about the receptionist. The receptionist is really, she's been doing demo vocals for all the songwriters, and she's not getting paid for it. He was really mad, and he was going to do a walkout with all the other songwriters. He wanted her to get paid for it. He didn't think it was fair. And I would see her when I would come in, I would chat with her. Her name was Trisha, and she was really good. And I was, you know, Raddy's really, you know, it was Trisha Yearwood.
No way.
She was a receptionist there. And so here's Radney trying to get her money because nobody would pay her to sing. And that's so, amazing. Yeah. And so the two of them wind up getting signed to RCA Records, and they want me to do their music video. So I do it. And so that got me into the whole Nashville major label music video scene.
There'll be those nights when glory comes round, and we'll tip our hats and wave to the crowd, and then ride that pony fast like a cow.
So I had my 15 minutes of fame at that point with doing all sorts of stuff that was on MTV and VH1 and CMT and wherever else, all over the place.
And then you worked with Garth Brooks for a while, right?
And then, yeah. Well, I had his manager when he first started out was a friend of mine. I had a partner when I was directing the music videos in Nashville, and he was actually the friend, and that's how I knew her, Pam Lewis. And so when Garth was, I was introduced to Garth. I don't know if he had a deal yet or he was about to get a deal. The problem was I was leaving. I was leaving now. I was moving back to New York, wound up living in Connecticut and working for Group W for about a year or so before I moved back to Nashville, realizing it was a mistake. But Garth was playing the Grand Ole Opry, and it was his first time, and he was in, and I happened to be walking around because I was working, I was leaving TNN, and I had the wife and my little girl, was little, and we went back to the Studio A where Hee Haw was shot. And so the Hee Haw cornfield is up. My daughter's playing in the cornfield, and they've got the front porch and the swing and all that. And I'm up there talking to Pam, because off in the other end, by the other side of the cornfield, they were refurbishing the dressing rooms at the backstage at the Opry, and they didn't have one for Garth. So they had a table with the big mirror and the lights around him, and there he is by himself, looking very lonely. And I'm talking to Pam, going, oh, I want to meet him. I love what I've heard. But he looks so nervous. I don't want to bother him. Is he going to be okay? Yeah, sure. Come over and say to him. Say hello to him. So I say hello to Garth. I just felt so bad for him, just by himself there. No, it's not. That's not normal for the Opry. Normally, you go backstage at the Opry. It's a lot of hubbub. It's a lot of fun. Yeah, I've been backstage at the Opry about 1,000 times. So that's his first time on the Opry. And I was trying to get in to do videos for him, but I had moved. And then the call comes in for a song called Friends in Low Places. And it would have come to me, but I was gone. And so it didn't, unfortunately.
Yeah.
So I missed out on that one. Sadly, I was not happy when I found out it was supposed to come to me and it didn't, because I was out of town. But nonetheless, all these years later, I wound up working with him anyway. He was in retirement, and he was coming out of retirement, and his executive producer called me up and asked me if, and I was living in Florida at the time. I got a call. I was living in Nashville. My mother calls me up and says, your father is dying. You can live anywhere. Can you help me? So I put everything in storage and moved to Florida, Sarasota, to help with my mom. And I got there on a Friday, and I thought, I'm going to go crazy just sitting around here. I got to do something. So Saturday, I started making calls around Florida. I only know a few people there, to see if I can find some sort of show to work on. And I heard about a national sport fishing television series for Fox Sports. And so I called about that on Monday. I met with them on Wednesday, and the show was mine. All of a sudden, I'm running a national sport fishing television series. I do the interview, and they go to me, so what do you know about fishing? And I was like, I don't know a thing about fishing. I said, do you want me to fish or do you want me to make a TV show? Because I know everything about TV shows.
Right.
And so that nasty New York attitude got me the job. And I did that for 3 years. My dad thankfully hung out for a year and a half. And then my mother did not do well by it. So I hung around for another year and a half with her. And then just the day I realized that, I called her up one day and I said, come on, let's meet for lunch. And she goes, well, I can't. I'm going to church and I'm going to meet some friends for lunch. And then I can see you around 2 o'clock, but then I'm going to see some other friends for dinner. And I thought, oh, mom is fine. I got to figure a way to get back to Nashville. And the phone rings. It was amazing. I just figured that out, and the phone rings and it's Garth. What are you doing in Florida? I need you to work. I need some stuff done for me. Well, it's not Garth. It's his manager, executive producer. And then Garth calls me after that. But anyway, so I wound up going up there working for him. So the timing was beyond perfect. It was, and so that was what brought me back. But so I wound up working with him for about 4 years. Is that right?
Wow.
He was coming out of retirement. And so I was getting material together for that, catching up with interviews and B-roll and stuff, telling bits and pieces of his story, and then doing promotional stuff. All sorts of things from commercials for CBS television, packages for the Today Show, including stuff for his two books that have come out.
Wow.
He's got a, But one of the last, in fact, I think one of the last things I did was the last book he had come out, which is not that long ago. If you download the Garth Brooks app and put it on your phone and then roll the phone over the book comes to life, or portions of it, they quote unquote come to life on your phone. And so I worked with the program guys. I made the video for that. And so I did the video for it. The programming guys really did the work for that. I can't claim that much claim for it, but you know, I do all sorts of crazy stuff like that.
The video market obviously has changed. I mean, you had MTV, you were there at the beginning of that. What's it like now? MTV doesn't play videos anymore. Everything's YouTube. It's a lot of self-produced. Is it tougher now for you to?
I came in just as they were happening and I left just as they were dying. Mm-hmm. As far as the big budget ones, because I would do, you know, major label, big budget videos. I would show up and I would shut down part of a city. I'd bring in a helicopter. I'd bring in a big Chapman crane. And I would have huge crews and I'd have actors and whatever I needed. Wow. I'd run around the country and do these things. And I did that from 1988 to around 1994. By the mid 90s, I was thinking, you know, the amount of money, time, and effort I put into 3.5 minutes, I could make a half hour show. I just got tired of doing it. And so I still do them on occasion, but they're usually for friends, people that I know that call me up and said, "Will you do it?" Yeah, I'll do one for the fun of it. And so I was doing it full time and doing as a business there for a while. And now I do them just because I want to do them. And you're right. I got out just as it was all dying. And you're right. It's YouTube, really, and it's Facebook. That's where the audience is. It's one or the other, depending on who you are. Right. I post on both because I'm dealing mostly with artists that are around my age. Excuse me. and so that audience is on Facebook. But I'll also post in YouTube, because what I discovered very quickly was Facebook does not fully distribute any videos that are not Facebook videos. So if you put a YouTube video on there, you're only going to get so many people liking it because only so many people can see it.
Oh, yeah.
So, yeah. And I've done the experiments. I actually did it again just a couple of weeks ago to see if it was still the case, and it is. Mm. I put one video up, I had one like and one comment in the first hour. And I put it as Facebook instead of YouTube, but YouTube first. And then Facebook the second time on Facebook. And all of a sudden, I had all these likes and all these comments. So, you know, this is the game they play. So, but you have to put it on YouTube as well, because if it's the press, or if it's a reviewer, or it's a blogger, or it's a fan page, they're going to link off of YouTube. So you need to do both. Mm-hmm. So, and that's where that is. And, you know, if you've got a cell phone, you can make a music video. It doesn't make them good, but you can make them. I mean, I've got all sorts of gear. I haven't used my cell phone. Not yet. Anyway, I should. Actually, it's not true. I did a commercial with my cell phone once.
Oh, did you really?
Well, it's a quasi commercial for a group called the Long Players. I happened to be, they were doing a benefit and they were doing a Creedence Clearwater Revival. And I was in the subway somewhere downtown in Manhattan. And there was a guy set up there. He's brilliant, Hispanic guy, and he had all these little mechanical dolls set up in front of him, and he's doing Creedence. And I was flipping out. And I said, "Do I have permission to shoot video for you? And I want to use it this promotional thing." And I threw two 20s into his little tit jar, and he was like, "Yes, use it." And with my cell phone, I shot this little promo, and it worked out really well, and I liked it. And it looked good. Amazing what you can do with a cell phone.
Now, what would you say is your most successful, like, what's the one that brought you over the top? Is there anything specific or?
Well, it depends on what you mean by that. As far as what got me more work, what got me personally over the top, what has the most views right now?
Yeah, maybe what has the most views.
The most views would be Alabama, the song of the South. That has 34 million views last time I looked at it.
Wow.
That's a few.
Song, song of the South. Sweet potato pie and I shut my mouth. Gone, gone with the wind. Ain't nobody looking back again. Song, song of the South.
I've got a few that have got a few million views on it.
That's great. That's great.
That's one.
And what about personally? What do you feel like you're most proud of?
The last one I did.
Yeah.
Actually, I've got one coming up, and he's going to hate me for telling you this, but Bill Lloyd, again, the guy that gave me my break in Nashville, I still keep up with all these people. And Bill's got power. He's big in power pop. And he's got something coming out, and he asked me to do a lyric video for a track.
But to find the truest path around all this misery, I learned to love like I'm somebody else. Mistakes were made, that's all I can say. Instead of drowning in the details, I do my best to let them flow. It's okay. Just forgive yourself and head for higher ground. Mistakes are made, but don't look down.
What I think is amazing, I don't know, I should ask these people. What they do is they give me a track and they say, here it is, see you later, goodbye. And I just make something and then they look at it. And I can't imagine you make a song and then somebody gives you their interpretation of it, and it's nothing like, you know, you imagined it would be. So I came up with this thing, and I really like it. He likes it. And so that comes out, I guess, in the next week or two.
Oh.
But, it's whatever I've just worked on. It's always a lot of fun, but they're all fun. I like them all.
That's great. That's great. Are there any that you regret? Oh, I shouldn't have done that.
Yes, and they're not online, as far as I know. Are there any that I regret? Not really, actually.
Not really.
I kind of like everything I've done.
Well, that's good.
And I don't have anything hidden in my archives. Mm-hmm. That doesn't mean I don't have everything. I thought I've collected everything to find out I haven't.
Mm-hmm.
I had a bunch of TV series that were about to go into production just before the pandemic hit. And that shut everything down.
Yeah.
Because I can't legally put a crew together. You know, I can't put people together. So it shut all sorts of stuff down. And so I've been doing these little projects. And while I was at it, I thought, well, I got to organize my archives. I've got terabytes and terabytes of stuff I've worked on for decades. I got to get this organized. And I started doing all these little videos for people for the fun of it. And no, I got paid for it, but you know, it's not like they're big deals. And some people have been asking me, send me some links on what you've done recently. And they were getting so many. I just made this one little video website page that just says the latest. So I said, here, go here. It's this way I don't eat up their email with a bunch of links. And then I had a request from one of my kids. What about your old stuff? And I was like, okay, fine. I'll put some of my old stuff up there. So now it's going out of control. I've got a video website
that's got
all these pages on it from different eras.
Yeah.
And I still have more. It's not done. But
now, it says on your website you won an Emmy. What's that all about?
No, I've got my daughter asked me how many awards I have. I had to search that out. I've got 67 awards. And one of them is an Emmy. I've got a couple of Emmy nominations. I got one win for editing. Foster and Lloyd. Again with Bill Lloyd for RCA Records. The song was called Before the Heartache Rolls In. In fact, Hootie and the Blowfish covered that song after that. That's how much they liked it. But it was a very arty-farty video.
Your eyes betray your heart and
they hired me to do an A and B side of their single. Before the Heartache Rolls In was the A side, and a song called Fat Lady Sings was the B side. So I heard Fat Lady Sings, and I was really into psychedelic stuff. So I did the psychedelic video for Fat Lady Sings, and RCA approved it. I couldn't believe a country label approved my psychedelic video, and it is true to psychedelia. I mean, I really researched how they did films in 1967 and all this, and I did the same thing. And it's a very funny video and did very, very well.
Well, they said it over, but so ain't really over. You can feel the premonition, but intuitions don't mean a thing till the fat lady sings.
Doing that, so you're still working.
I
don't like to talk about the C word too much. I don't like to say COVID, but you know.
Well, you know, I've had my one shot, and the other shot's coming up. You get to a certain age, and that gets you higher on the list for things like these shots. So, in fact, here I'll tell. Maybe some people know this. I register online in the state. I go to different places to try to the day, the morning, 4 o'clock in the morning, the day that I'm available. And all of a sudden things are already booked. And so I can't get any. So I figured, well, this is way out in the country in Tennessee. I'm going to go here. Bang. And I get right in. It's a Grinder Switch, Tennessee. Grinder Switch is the home of Minnie Pearl. Now, I worked with Minnie Pearl in the 80s when I was at TNN.
Wow.
And what a sweet lady. I really liked her. I got some stories that I can't tell you about her that are great. Well, I like her a lot. Anyway, so I thought, Grinder Switch, perfect. I'm going to Grinder Switch. And I get there, and what vaccine do I get? I get the Moderna vaccine, which was funded by Dolly Parton, who I've also, you know, I love Dolly Parton. She's done me favors. I like Dolly Parton. And so I figured if I had to go anywhere for my vaccine, this was to get the Dolly Parton shot in Minnie Pearl's hometown. Yes, thank you very much. Happy to have it. So otherwise, I'm working on a bunch of TV shows, TV series. I had a bunch that were going into production when this shut down. I've got one that's being talked about.
Can you name any of the TV shows?
I can, but I can't tell you.
Okay.
But if I can, I wish I could. There's one out of London that's a big deal, rock music documentary series that if I told you it was with, it would be a big deal.
Okay.
Everybody signed on. I just got to get through the pandemic, but it should happen. I've been working on it for years. Mm-hmm. I've got a very crazy sports music series that's being talked about right now with one network and a Hollywood group right now. Actually, I'll find out more about that next week. I had a Americana series I was asked to run, produce and direct out of North Carolina. That was shut down, but now that I've got calls on that. So they're talking about possibly doing the pilot for the series in November. And there was a blues series for out of Mississippi. Mm-hmm. I was asked to run also. And I got an email on that yesterday saying, now that the shots are happening, that may happen. And the two guys that were originally booked as the guest stars in there, I wish I could tell you. Because it was even flipping me out because I didn't book these guys. They did. Oh, and that meant I hung around with these guys. I love it. The best part of my job, when I was a kid, I had 1,000 records, literally. All these years later, most of the people in my old record collection are either friends of mine, people I've met, people I bumped into, and a couple of cases I've stayed overnight in their houses.
Wow.
So I love this job. Just for that reason alone. Nobody has to pay me. I'm just happy to do it.
And it's all from Record Stop. You know, it's funny.
It's all from Record Stop. Oh, I mean, okay. Here's my, Bruce told me I am historically set in, I have my one little note in Record Stop history.
Yeah.
When Record Stop first opened up, I found out about it through my college girlfriend, who was, she was really into British progressive rock, which got me into all that. And of course, years later, I wound up working with the Straubs and Annie Haslam from Renaissance. I was in love with her back then. And here I was become passionate. She did a piece of artwork for me. I'd show you on the walls. It's in the back. But anyway, so my girlfriend wants Lesion Leaf from, you can't get the record anywhere. You know, Sam Goody's is it. If it's a little record store. They have top 40 singles, a couple of albums, and nothing. So if you want albums, Fairport Convention, Lesion Leaf Fairport Convention. See,
right, I remember. Right, okay.
Sam Goody's would have it, but I found out about Record Stop, and it just opened. So I went in there, and I ordered Lesion Leaf from, a couple of days later, came, picked up the album, gave it to my girlfriend. She was very happy, mm-hmm. and that got me into Record Stop. I got started hanging around there. Mm-hmm. And Bruce said to me, I was the very first special order for Record Stop. Yes, I was.
That's funny.
So I'm very proud of that.
That's a badge of honor right there.
I've got a wall full of awards. I want that one. That's up there somewhere. It's got to be.
A lot of great stuff. Steve, I have to wrap this up.
Yeah, we're talking. I've abused privileges way too long.
This was great, Steve. Nice seeing you again.
Fantastic. Thanks for inviting me. This is fun to yammer, and thanks for letting me yammer on and on and on.
It was my pleasure, believe me. All right. Steve Boyle, what a guest, huh? My goodness. Suffocating in Suburbia, Stevie GB. Thank you very much.
Steve's Buggy!